Be silent. Be still. Alone. Empty. Before your God. Say nothing. Ask nothing. Be silent. Be still. Let your God look upon you. That is all. God knows, understands, loves you with an enormous love. God only wants to look upon you with love. Quiet. Still. Be. Let your God love you. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. We come before your presence, you who are common to us all. God in the midst, come close to us, and help us to come close to you. As for a fraction of time, we step back from the activities and demands of the day. So if, as this day goes on, we forget you, do not forget us, O God. Amen. Holy Wisdom, delight of our God, you open our ears, we hear your word. You enter deep into the being of humanity. Foolish to the world, you will unmask our follies. You are a shelter to us by day, and a steady flame through the night. You lead us through turbulent waters, and bring us safe to dry ground. You open the mouths of those who are mute. You loosen the tongues of infants in their cries. A little child takes us by the hand and leads us to freedom and truth. Holy Wisdom, delight of our God, you open our ears, we hear your word. Glory to God, source of all being, eternal Word and Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Psalm 131, a song of quiet trust. O Lord, my heart is not lifted up. My eyes are not raised too high. I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvellous for me, but I have calmed and quieted my soul. Like a weaned child with its mother, my soul is like the weaned child that is with me. Spirit of Wisdom, take from us all fuss, the clattering of noise, the temptation to dominate by the power of words, the craving for certainty. Lead us through the narrow gate of not knowing, that we may listen and obey, and come to a place of silence and stillness, of true conversation and wisdom. And now we listen to Canon Bruce's reflection.
When Jesus sent out his disciples to share in his work, they were told, among other things, to visit the sick. Today, then, a few strange or funny things that happened to me in carrying out that work. The first was while I was a deacon at St. Mark's in the late 1950s. There were three of us curates sharing a clergy house, and we were looked after by a housekeeper. One Sunday, during lunch, a phone call came from St. James's Hospital to say that a lady that I'd been visiting was near to death. I got on my scooter and buzzed down to the hospital. When I arrived, the sister said to me, "It's no use trying to talk to her. She's way beyond all that." I came to the bedside, and before praying with the lady, I decided to say the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd," and so on. But before I got to the second verse, the lady joined in, and we completed the psalm together before I prayed for God's blessing upon her. Another amusing incident happened over a very serious call out to the dying. It was soon after Angela and I were married, and we'd moved into Loxheath, where I'd become vicar. One Saturday evening in winter, a local young man was caught up in a major fight outside one of the pubs. He was gravely injured and had been rushed to hospital in Southampton. His parents had phoned me at about 9 o'clock to ask me to pray for them and their son. I did so, and not long after that, Angela and I went off to bed. At around 1 a.m., we were woken by another phone call asking me to come to the hospital as the boy was dying. I got out of bed and started to put on my black cassock and cloak, ready to drive to Southampton. Angela insisted on coming with me for safety reasons, so when we got to the hospital, I walked into the ward with Angela a few paces behind me. The sister came towards me and said, "Thank you for coming, Father." She then spotted Angela, and thinking that I was a Roman Catholic priest, she said, "Perhaps your friend would like to wait in my office." A truly hilarious thing happened on another call out. A member of the church congregation rang one morning to tell me that the elderly lady next door was ill in bed and had said she'd like to see a priest. I said I'd call that afternoon, and I was told to go in by the back door, which would be open, and go straight upstairs. I did just that, walked in through the kitchen and straight up. When I entered the bedroom and I said, "Hello, Mrs. So-and-so," she said, "Oh, doctor, I'm very ill, I'm so thin." And she flung back the bedclothes and lay there stark naked. I quickly covered her up again and managed to explain I was the vicar and that after I'd prayed with her, I would ring the doctor. I was briefly ill myself once while working in Richmond. One Sunday, as I was about to start the 8 o'clock Eucharist, I suffered agonizing pains. Luckily, a doctor in the congregation acted quickly and called an ambulance, assuming it was a heart attack. It was, in fact, only gallstones, and it was sorted in a matter of days. However, Angela came with me to the hospital in the ambulance, and at one point she took hold of my hand. "My dear," said the paramedic, "please don't do that. You've sent his heart rate up alarmingly." Next week, my exchange with an Orthodox priest in Russia.
Throughout this day, enliven our minds, inspire our conversation, inform our decisions, and protect those we love. And should today bring what we neither anticipate nor desire, increase our faith and decrease our pride, until we know that when we face the unexpected, we do not stand alone. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.